Your top headlines for the week ending April 13. Husband baffled as wife disappears for 21 days without a trace. City magistrate to face Judicial Service Commission for barring transgender from his courtroom. CG motorcycle bandits punks on a group at a farewell hand. Pedal cyclist dies in linen accident. New Demerara Harbor Bridge to be built at Houston. Gaisuku's future still unknown. Cato Secondary to be completed by September. Welcome to MTV's News Updates Week in Review for the week ending April 13. I am Trisha Ramla. Good afternoon. The Ghana Youth Tires Association staged another protest at State House, calling for the ban on importation of used tires to be reversed. The ban commenced on April 1.
The Ghana Youth Tire Association will not allow the ban on the importation of used tires to go unnoticed. They once again staged a picketing exercise outside of State House, calling on the government to reverse the decision. Speaking with the irate protesters, they claimed that it is too burdensome to purchase new tires. Some claimed that the used tires are better suited for Guyana, as the masses of Guyanese are not wealthy.
If you buy a new tire, eventually after 2-3 months, you can still become like a used tire. And you have to spend like $18,000 for one, which in you can get 4 used tires for about the same $18,000. And it will last you 4 to 6 months. And the new tire will last you about the same thing too. All over the world, you have a choice as a citizen of the country to buy new tire or used tire. I don't know why they want to phase away used tire.
Used tire is my business. I depend on used tire. This is my only work I do for, I sell used tire since 1988.
This used tires is very good for us because a lot of poor people in this country cannot afford to buy the new tires. And it's very, very hard for people, especially like the bus drivers, the car taxi drivers, them. It's very hard for them.
It's rough. It's really, really rough. Because new tires can't stand up. The rubber is not make it, you know. Used tires, best use the used tires. They got to drop the taxi whatsoever. That no. New tires can't work this country at all.
Used tire is far cheaper than the new tire. The new tires what they bring in don't have the durability as the foreign used tire. Those tires when you see they bring in from China coming from a dump. While the company restrict, we ain't got the capacity of the tire. The rubber. When that tire, the new tire come in, it's no good.
It is affecting me because my husband have a taxi and to buy a new tire, it's very expensive. Right now with everything that going on, the VAT on electricity, on water and everything.
They are appealing to the government to reverse the decision which they claimed is only suited for a particular group of people.
I like to say to the government or who in authority, they could invite the Youth Tire Association, all importer and who sell tire to have a discussion. And let we come to one compromise. Whoever in authority and restrict this tire, they are trying to please them friend. But let them remember that them and them friend, the people them cry in this country, the poor people them will fall on them. Don't try to please nobody. Try to please that man up there. And then that man will pleased with you.
With the passage of annual budget 2017, a ban was instituted on the importation of used tires. This took effect from April 1. However, the Used Tire Association and the Ghana Minibus Union have been calling for the decision to be reversed even before it was enforced. They were also calling for the government to have consultation on the way forward, but to no avail. Will the government hold further consultation and reverse the ban on the importation of used tires? Only they can tell us. Reporting for MTV News Update from the protest scene at the State House, Godfrey Brooms.
Following completion of a feasibility study and design for the new Demerara Harbor Bridge, the Houston Versailles site has been deemed as a preferential area for the construction of the new bridge. However, for the bridge and adjoining roads to be built, lands need to be acquired.
The feasibility study for the new bridge, which is being funded by the government, was executed by the Leveson CSO Contracting BV. The study, which commenced in January of this year, has cited a Houston Versailles site as a preferable location for the construction of the new bridge. This is according to leader of the feasibility study team, Hari Arimal.
The road system is rather limited. You can see it here, that basically the road system consists of a bridge and two bank roads, the west and the eastern bank road. That means if something happens on the bridge, everything is blocked, but the same holds for this road and basically also for these roads.
Noting no definitive decision has been made, Minister of Public Infrastructure David Paterson says land acquisition would be necessary to facilitate road extensions. However, those occupants of houses and properties who will be affected will be consulted in due time.
I do expect that anybody that may, whose home or property that may be affected would obviously feel aggrieved. We will obviously have consultations with them whenever that final decision is made. But unfortunately, as I said in the opening, doing nothing is not an option.
Meanwhile, road traffic analyst Jacqueline Moreau says additional road extensions will be needed on both the east and western landing sites as traffic is predicted to increase. In addition to this, a three-lane road will better facilitate the growth in traffic, while a high and low bridge has been shown as the most preferred bridge type. Sandy Ramutar for MTV's News Update.
Chairman of the Guyana Sugar Corporation, Professor Clive Thomas, says they are awaiting government's response on where the sugar industry is heading. Find out more in this report.
Professor Clive Thomas, during an exclusive interview, says following a meeting with Gaisuka and the government in November last, they are still awaiting the government's decision on the future of the industry. He noted that that crucial decision will determine the future of the corporation.
We have not gotten official support and official word on that as yet. I hear that there might be some introduction of possible white paper or something to the parliament tomorrow. That's what I heard. I can't confirm that because that was not given to me officially, but that's what they expect.
Despite the waiting period of government's final decision, Professor Thomas says Gaisuku is seeking foreign assistance to commence the aquaculture and hydroponics projects. Professor Thomas says in keeping with the Global Green Fund, they are seeking several billions of dollars to commence the projects.
And they give out grants up to $50 million for attempts to set up aquaponics, agricultural support, things that are green, and we are in the process of submitting an application for a project.
Gaisuka has over the years been solely dependent on bailouts from the past and present administrations to offset its finances. The industry is grappling with the low world prices for sugar, the closure of several estates, coupled with protest after protest. The government has recently transferred $1 billion to the corporation to pay workers. The Minister of Agriculture noted that Gaisuka needs an additional $18 billion to stay afloat for the remainder of 2017. Nikhil John, the reporting for MTV News Update.
Turning our attention to crime, a group of persons were having a farewell party last night on Regent Street was robbed by three CG motorcycle bandits. The bandits, who abandoned their motorbike before escaping in a waiting motor car, fired several shots in the air. Details in this report.
It was around 21:30 when the CG motorcycle bandits pounced on their victims who were having a farewell party on Regent Street. Reports are that when the bandits walked up to the gathering, they told them that it was a stick-up. It was when everyone froze that the bandits proceeded to relieve them of their gold jewelry, cellular phones, and car keys.
It was two of them, one dressed like a police. Yes. One dressed like a police was standing there, and the other one was standing here. And he said, nobody move, and I run, and when I look back, he shoot up in the air, because I run inside here.
During the ordeal, one of the women began to wrestle with one of the bandits. However, the other bandit used the opportunity to fire shots in the air, which ended the scuffle.
I was dancing. I was don't move. My left's a freeze. What's all I going to do? Because like, I don't know where they're going on.
But before they could have escaped on their motorcycles, A driver saw what transpired and crashed into one of the motorcycles which were parked on the road. The man then abandoned the CG motorcycle and ran into Orinoco Street, where a silver motor car picked up the two bandits. Reports are that the silver car was parked at the corners of Regent and Orinoco Streets for quite a while. The other accomplice sped off on his motorbike. Ranks of the police force responded quickly but were unable to apprehend the bandits. The police are reviewing surveillance footage to ascertain the identity of the men and the silver car. Nikhil John, the reporting for MTV News Update.
The Lennon Highway has claimed another life, this time a 21-year-old pedal cyclist who was bulldozed by a speeding car. More in this report.
Commander of E Division Fazil Karambash says the driver is still in custody assisting with the investigation. Commander Karambash says both the cyclist and the motorist were heading in the same direction when the latter crashed into the cyclist. The accident occurred approximately 16 hours 40 on the Silver Hill Public Road Linden Highway. That is 21-year-old Raymond Isaacs of Silver Hill Linden. The police in a statement said the motor car, HC7383, was proceeding north along the Western Carjery at a fast rate. The car smashed into the cyclist, who was flung onto the front windshield and then onto the roadway. Isaacs was picked up in an unconscious state and was rushed to the Linden Hospital Complex, where he was pronounced dead on arrival. The police say the high car driver of West Wetuka Hilltop, Wisma Linden, is assisting with the investigation. Nikhil John, the reporting for MTV News Update.
Another tragic accident, this time on the Essequibo Coast, has left one dead and two other critically injured. More in this report.
The car ended up in the trench along the Salem Public Road around 9 hours 30 this morning. That is 21-year-old Diol Gobin of Perica East Bank, Essequibo. According to an eyewitness, he saw the car sped past him, which was driven by one of the three men, who are now seriously injured while one is dead.
By the time I ran up to them, they were, it was almost like half day, so I couldn't do much. By the time you get help on thing, then we will get help.
In the trench before?
Yeah, it toppled in the trench, alongside the road.
So they were heading up
and out? No, they were going in along in Road and Ross. They were going to Road and Ross at the same time. Then that happened.
Reports are that the three men were heading to the Perica Backlands to attend to their farm. It was observed at the accident scene that two bottles of chemicals were retrieved from the trench, along with a pair of long boots.
He was going in the back down, the farm, say drugs and something taken up. So I don't know how them is going there. Yeah, my son and another friend who died.
One of the two survivors, Ricky Ramnott, was rushed to the Lenora Cottage Hospital. However, he was transferred to the West Demerara Regional Hospital. Ramnott remains in an unconscious state up to press time. The identity of the other individual who is receiving treatment at the Lenora Cottage Hospital is yet to be known. Nikhil John, the reporting for MTV News Update.
An elderly man has lost his life in an early morning blaze on the Quarantine Coast. The fire of unknown origin gutted the two-story house. Details in this report.
Dead is 82-year-old Randolph Ross of Kildonan, Quarantine, Berbice. Ross, who was living at the premises after retiring as an overseer for the community, began to call for help, but unfortunately, help came too late. According to a neighbor, he heard loud screams for help from the man's house. The man explained that he and other residents began to douse the blaze, however, that also proved futile.
And tried to get the house, but we failed. Every way we tried, we failed because the heat was too much, you know, and the smoke. So, make a couple of efforts, failed. I had to go to save my house after that, because the fire started spreading across.
The neighbor further explained that when the fire engines arrived, there was little they could have done to save the house, which was already gutted.
He's mobile, but not 100%. He's an 82-year-old person we're talking about, you know. And it's somebody that one of his legs is not too good, you know. Yeah, I think he's diabetic, so you should understand what I'm saying. So he have a kind of wound on his foot, you know.
Meantime, the man's son, who arrived after the fire, was taken into custody. The relative was living with the deceased, but was not at home at the time of the fire. The Guyana Fire Service has launched a probe to ascertain the cause of the fire. Nikhil Jondo reporting for MTV News Update.
5 persons are now homeless after a jilted fish vendor set his house on fire, allegedly in a drunken rage.
36-year-old Cinerine Cyril is still on the run after he set his house ablaze on Monday night, April 10, 2017. Reports indicate that Cyril had an argument with his wife, Sarita Sawindra, about a pedal cycle he left in the yard. As a result of the argument, the woman left the home with her 3 children. Sawindra says after she left, she received a call that the house was engulfed in flames.
Then we can say yes, we can say no, because I see, and we can't send the soul to somebody else.
We got problem with anybody?
No, we don't have problem with nobody. Me and everybody good.
The woman says the man had threatened to burn the house on numerous occasions and would also threaten to take his own life.
No, we don't know if he can do nothing, because he not come out, we have not go anyway. Yeah, because without he have no current, he have no nothing, so he not got to hold him on. No, somebody got to build it.
Firefighters from Rose Hall Fire Service arrived at the scene but were unable to save the building. Nikhil Jondo reporting for MTV News Update.
A husband is trying to locate his wife, who disappeared on March 20 after journeying to Georgetown to pay some bills. The man claims that he has been relentlessly searching for his wife during the past 21 days.
Vikram Naipaul, during an exclusive interview with News Update, says his wife, Sita Prasad, left home on March 20th, 2017 to pay an installment at the Small Business Bureau. Naipaul says his 20-year-old wife is not familiar with the capital city and believes she may have lost her way.
But she thinks she knows tongue. I don't know. She says she knows the route now. I don't know how she last. I don't know. I seen last year, one now and then. Most time is go. Or 1-2 time is bring she with me. Or some friend, or you know, close family friends come with she. But the same she won't come. She no talk much well.
The man explained that he made a missing persons report at the Bergdam police station but has received no response to date. Naipaul says after his wife went missing, 2 persons have been using her mobile number.
Something they don't answer. When I ask, 2 times they call me on this number, a male and a female call me and ask who is this. I tell my husband for this girl, and I would like to speak to her, and they cut off. Something I asked, I call and answer, some girl in Talima, she says she's Talima. I don't know who is it. And after the black man number.
Nikhil John, the reporting for MTV News Update.
A city magistrate will now be placed before the Judicial Service Commission following an allegation of misconduct perpetrated against members of the trans community.
Following repeated denial of entry into the courtroom for several members of the trans community, the Guyana Trans United wrote a letter of complaint on March 20, 2017, requesting the intervention of the Judicial Service Commission. Speaking with this newscast, Director of the GTU, Quincy McEwen, says the alleged denial of justice, which was meted out to the trans community by Magistrate Dylan Best, has set a bad precedence. Magistrate Best has on several occasions barred from his courtroom transgender persons wearing female attire, McEwen said.
It's a law that we wanted to be struck down, because trans persons continue to be barred by this law, and this law only affects certain persons in society, and is the most marginalized community, which is the trans person it affect, because women dress as male every day and access services and don't be barred from having those services.
The GTU director is of the view that Magistrate Best should be sanctioned for his alleged continuous misconduct. He says the action led out by the official has created many challenges for the trans community.
And we were saying the improper purpose was two-faced, and we see clearly when Dylan Best continue to use the improper purposes when trans women appear before his courtroom, and he act out against by barring trans when they have a matter. So we really basically send the letter to highlight some of the challenge what the magistrate has been interpreted as is the improper purpose.
As the community eagerly awaits the result of the Judicial Service Commission's hearing, the GTU has expressed relief as a response was made to the group by the JSC. Sandy Ramutar for MTV's News Update.
Following the $61.7 million budgeted to repair the defects of the Cato Secondary School, the institution will be ready to unveil its new structure for the new school year come September.
3 years ago, the previous administration, People's Progressive Party, paid some $1 billion to Cars Engineering Incorporated to construct the institution in Region 8. However, the shady work done by the contractor has been deemed unsafe due to its many defects. Minister of Public Infrastructure David Paterson says his government is committed to repair the defects of the institution at a fast pace to facilitate the opening of it in the new school year.
Yeah, they've already committed that they will do whatever it takes, obviously under very strict supervision. If it's not up to, and it has to be accepted by the community and an independent body is announced. So when that happens, we'll look at it. But we're hoping to have the school open if possible for the new school term.
Following the shady construction by Cars Engineering Inc., parents and children in the community has forced the ministry to reorganize their plans as the students are unable to attend school. The school was intended to catering for 400 students, 250 of whom will be facilitated in a new dormitory. Sandy Ramutar for MTV's News Update.
That's a wrap for MTV's News Updates Week in Review. The newscast can be viewed online on our MTV's Facebook page and also on our YouTube channel. Join us April 18 for another edition of MTV's News Update. On behalf of our news team, I am Trish Ramla, thanking you for watching.